Sometimes you see some type of protocol and then it works for somebody and then it gets dropped on the internet and then it should work for everybody and it's the best and it's golden. And okay, but where's the context here? I mean, not everybody is the same. Not everybody should be treated the same. We're always trying to look, okay, it has to be black or white. It has to be fixed. Nothing in nature is fixed.
A lot of patients are using supplements to go on with the lifestyle they have so they can do bad things and balance it with supplements.
You should not depend on supplements and medicines, and you should be in a high energetic state so you can do what you want to do. Nutrition is more than fuel. It's information as well. It tells you something about the environment. Always go for organic. Yeah, and that's not the golden standard, and it's not perfect, and there are some toxins in organic food as well, but it's way less than in regular food.
Welcome, my name is Matthijs and you're listening to Injured Dumbass, your go-to podcast if you want to get rid of your injuries and optimize your health. I've seen more than 40 physiotherapists, podiatrists, had a knee surgery, an MRI scan, and saw many more professionals that didn't know how to help me with my injuries. And after 5 years of struggling, a man named Gerben Hierik helped me with a fairly unknown form of therapy called PDTR. He fixed my knee stabilization in 2 hours. Something that all the previous professionals could not achieve. And after that experience, I swore to dedicate my life to learning and sharing problem-solving knowledge. Everything to optimize your health and help you to get rid and stay away from injuries.
Gezondheid draait niet om voeding, maar het draait om energie. Het draait dus om elektromagnetisme opwekken en het is niet voeding afhankelijk.
I have the question for the people who have absolutely no clue what is TRE.
Okay.
Injuries?
Because I was wondering, have you ever dealt with physical injuries?
Yes, I did. And
A very big shout out and thank you of today's sponsor, Ergomax. Quality supplements for people who care about their health. Use the code MATTHIJS10 at the checkout for a 10% discount.
Welcome to Injured Dumbass. My name is Matthijs and today my guests are Melon and Thomas. A brief introduction about Thomas. Thomas van Doorn, an expert in the field of quantum biology. Before Thomas devoted himself to this, he was active on a high performance level in tennis. And this allows top athletes to easily connect with him. And Thomas believes and wants optimal health to be achievable for everybody. And that is why he set up Your Health Concept. To make people healthier through the latest science to bring out the best in people. And also a previous and highly appreciated guest of this channel. And then we have Melon van Ravenstein, a co-founder of Your Health Concept. Originally a dentist, she is also focused on holistic medicine. And Melon combines an academic background with an automolecular and quantum biological way of thinking and treatment. And by treating the body as a whole system and finding the cause of the problem, Melon has been successful with clients where traditional treatments did not bring sufficient results. And she's the first author of the effect of omega-3 fatty acids on the periodontal therapy, systematic review and meta-analysis. And this March, she is presenting her research in Washington, D.C. for the International Association for Dental Research, if I'm saying that correct.
Yes, thank you.
And through a personal approach with practical, applicable content, she helps people to feel vital and balanced in all cells of their body and keep chronic diseases out as long as possible. So guys, how is it to be back in Haarlem today?
Nice, thank you for having us.
So today we are talking about the context of health. there was something that was on your mind when the last time we spoke.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
something that lots of experts and therapists miss, in your opinion.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Sometimes you see some type of protocol and then it works for somebody and then it gets dropped on the internet and then it should work for everybody and it's the best and it's golden. And yeah, that's something I'm missing big time when I watch health-related topics on the internet. Like, okay, but where's the context here? I mean, not everybody is the same. Not everybody should be treated the same. So yeah, that's something that's always in my mind. And that's what we try to teach at Your Health Concept through videos like this or on our Instagram. Yeah, okay, something could be working for somebody, but that doesn't mean that it's also working for you 100% of the time.
Yeah, and we were talking about some different topics like veganism, and we're cutting that cake open with the game changers, for instance. The Wim Hof method,
yeah.
As you see with lots of Wim Hof method instructors, that they have health of skin problems.
Yeah, maybe not health problems, but yeah,
skin problems.
Yeah, they're talking a lot about their skin problems, and yeah, it goes with Wim Hof as well. Not for everybody, but some of them have the problems there.
Yeah, vegetarianism, a carnivore diet, paleo. I mean, everybody has something new. I mean, this diet cured me from this, and this, and then suddenly new health problems start to arise and people ask themselves, why is this happening? And then they change to a new diet. And after a couple of months, they change to a new diet. And what are your thoughts on those topics? So maybe we can start with the game changers, with veganism, for instance.
Yeah, so we're talking about context, and in the game changers documentary, I'm missing the context there. So for example, that's the example that's always on my mind. There's an athlete there, and his name is Brian Jennings.
Mm-hmm.
And he switched from a certain type of diet. Later on in the documentary, he admits that it was mostly a fast food diet and vegetables like asparagus or something like that. He didn't know them prior, before he started to do a whole plant-based diet. So yeah, of course, when that guy is coming from a fast food diet, or mostly fast food diet, not eating vegetables, not eating healthy grass-fed, grass-finished beef, and he's switching to a plant-based diet, of course you're gonna see some benefits there, and he's gonna feel better, and maybe his digestion is gonna be a little bit better. But yeah, where are you coming from? I'm missing that in the documentary with a lot of stuff. So there's also a little bit of some athletes, and they were saying that you need carbohydrates to perform explosively. So if you look at basic human physiology, yeah, then that's the case. You need carbohydrates to be explosive, of course. But that doesn't mean that you only have to eat carbohydrates and that meat is the devil and that it's bad. No, there's a context to that. And in the game changers, I'm missing a lot of context.
Mm. And what are your thoughts on that, Camille?
I think a vegan diet can help you in the short term with short-term problems. And I think not only one of us is eating like they are describing in a documentary, like processed meats and bad quality meat. So I think when you eat meat, it has to be good quality, because you can eat a lot of meat, but when it's not good quality.
What is good quality in your eyes?
I think 100% grass-fed and from organic biological sources.
Mm.
Yeah.
And how do you use veganism or a veganism approach in the in healing the health problems of your patients?
We don't use vegan diets for healing with our patients. We also we always describe omega-3s and other vitamins you can get enough from a vegan diet.
Mm.
Yeah, most of the people we get in the practice already have a problem with insulin sensitivity, with eating a modern Western diet for, let's say, 20 or 25 years, and that diet is based on carbohydrates. So they're already eating way too much carbohydrates, and the type of carbohydrates they eat are, yeah, 9 out of 10 times are pretty shit as well. So it's processed, GMO, a lot of refined sugars, there's way too much fruit. People eat like fruit because it's healthy. They eat it like 5 or 6 times a day. Mm-hmm. So what we always try to do is get learn them a lot more about good quality food. So organic, pasture-raised eggs, grass-fed, but also grass-finished beef, so that the omega-6 and the omega-3 ratio in the meat is good. There are not a lot of pesticides, herbicides, fungicides, rodenticides on the foods in general. So that's one of the things we use. And that was something I was missing in the Game Changers as well, is the fact that cholesterol is a precursor for almost every hormone. Mm-hmm. So if I'm not getting the right fats in, or animal fats in, then it's harder for the body to produce those hormones. And when your insulin levels are always high, or you have a lot of stress because of the way you live, your environment, you're drinking way too much alcohol, that's what we see in a lot of patients as well, then you need more hormone production. Could be adrenaline, could be cortisol, but also those hormones need a precursor from cholesterol to be made. So if there's no cholesterol in the body, or no animal saturated fats, then it's harder for the body. I'm not saying that it's not possible, but it's not optimal. And that's what Game Changers is not focused on. Game Changers is focused on sports, mm-hmm. but not focused on optimal health. And that can be two totally different things, right, or goals.
Yeah, and all the people are talking about B12. I think that's the most important thing, but it's pretty hard for the body to get from carotenes to vitamin A, and from linoleic acid to EPA and DHA. So I think a vegan diet, it's not seasonal, because we live in a high latitude here. Mm-hmm. So we don't get a lot of sun in winters. So especially in winters, I think it's not a good idea to eat a vegan diet.
And that's because you're missing all the nutrients you just described.
Yeah, and I think when you are closer to the equator, you mm-hmm. have more sun. The sun will help you with vitamin B production, and vitamin D production you miss a lot with a vegan diet. So I think it's not a good idea to eat a vegan diet over here. And maybe sometimes in summer you can eat a vegan for a couple of months, but I think the whole year is not a good idea.
And what is your opinion on the kidney, for instance? I'm following a top athlete on Instagram, and she also does talks, and one of her latest posts was on the kidney, because it has to break down the tissue, if I'm saying this correctly, from the amino acids, and you get a toxic residue, and the kidney has to get rid of all the stuff.
When you're eating a highly plant-based diet, you mean?
No, when you're eating meat, it has to work 4 or 5 hours, she described.
Yeah, that could be the case. Also, that depends on the context. How much meat are you eating, and is your digestive tract, is it in order? But normally, when the digestive tract is in order, it's fine to eat meat. B12.
Okay, you ate it for let's say breakfast, lunch, dinner.
Yes and no. So let's make it simple. We live in the Netherlands here. It's February at the moment. Where do you find carbohydrates in nature? So let's say, for example, a banana, or I don't know, a broccoli or something like that. Does it grow at the moment? No, the answer is no. Most of the vegetables and most of the fruits are not growing at this moment. So what will we eat if we were out in nature, let's say 300, 400 years ago? What will we eat? Yeah, mostly animal products. Mm-hmm. So there was no other choice. So the system is built for the winter time to work with mostly protein and lipids or fat. And in the summertime, it's working more towards to carbohydrates, because it's in the environment as well. And that's something I'm missing in Game Changers also, is nutrition is more than fuel. It's information as well. It tells you something about the environment. And the environment now, with a lot less UV, different temperature, is totally different than in the summertime. But when I'm eating that banana, it's telling the body clocks, that it's summer. So is it good for you to eat 3 times meat every day, 12 months out of the year? I wouldn't say it's bad, because a carnivore diet is something that people get really good health benefits from. But it's not something that we recommend at your health concept. Change your food seasonally and get, eat what's able.
Yeah, and I think every diet has pros and cons, because some people are scared about eating much fish because about the heavy metals. And I think it's the same with the kidney.
Yeah. So we're built.
When your redox system is okay, you don't have to be scared about heavy metals. Your body will detoxify it.
Mm.
Yeah.
And also there, what's your source of fish? I mean, where is it coming from? Is it what is the quality of it? So, because we change so much with food production, food isn't food anymore.
So how would you help somebody with learning and understanding what is quality food and how do I find quality food?
You experience stress, tension, trauma, and you want to learn how to deal with this yourself. Well, then this tool is for you. And I'm talking about tension and trauma release exercises, also known as TRE. And in my 9-year healing journey, this has become one of my absolute favorites that I still use today, every day. And it's a very simple yet innovative series of exercises that assist the body in releasing deep muscular patterns of stress, tension, and trauma, created by Dr. David Buscelli, PhD. Now, TRE safely activates a natural reflex mechanism of shaking or vibrating that releases muscular tension, calming down the nervous system. When this muscular shaking, vibrating mechanism is activated in a safe and controlled environment, then the body is encouraged to return back to a state of balance. And the beauty is, it is like learning how to drive a bike, so you only need to learn it once. And all my viewers and listeners get a 25% discount. So use the code ID25 at the checkout and enjoy the rest of this interview.
Yeah, there are a lot of ways to teach people that. The first and the easy one is always go for organic. Yeah, and that's not the golden standard, and it's not perfect, and there are some toxins in organic food as well, but it's way less than in regular food. That's one of the first things. The second thing is get rid of products that not are real foods, are not for real. So you can buy an organic Snicker, but it's still not a real food. It doesn't grow in nature. So keep your food template easy and natural. So you can eat fruits, vegetables, fish, meat, everything that grows on earth. That's already way better than eating an organic cookie or organic potato chips.
Yeah, and I think systemically and locally is the way to go, because when you can grow it in your garden, it's nature tells us it's okay to eat it now.
Yeah.
So I think that's a good sign that All you right. can eat it.
So to get back to the game changers, they're missing context and.
Yeah, and I think the science is really bad in Game Changers. And
why do you think that?
One thing, you only describes the cases that went well, and they forgot all the cases that were in public.
So we're not saying that it is because of the vegan diet, but in Game Changers they're saying it's because meat.
Yeah, because of meat. Yeah, because of the vegan diet, I was in a fighting game. Gregor McConnor.
Nadia is a vegetarian.
Won the game because he was a vegan. Now I think.
No, it's but crap. Then speaking of, on his endurance, and I know from the training method of Conor McGregor, he used lots of cycling. And that was also one of the things you saw against Floyd Mayweather. Yeah, I mean, if you're doing lots of cycling, your body is going to adapt to the form of stress. And his form of stress was this mode. So during his fight, he was also tending to get a bit more forward. You also saw that with Floyd Mayweather, and his condition was off. I mean, but has that to do everything with meat? Then they just specifically look towards the food and not the rest of his day. Yeah. How does he sleep? Does he have a Wi-Fi router next to his head when he's sleeping? Does he have his phone on while he sleeps next to his head?
How is his circadian rhythm?
How is his relationships with people around?
Yeah, that's exactly the point we try to make. So we're not saying game changers is bad or it's all bullshit. No, that's not the point we try to make. The point we try to make is that there's missing a lot of context in the documentary. And that's fine. It is what it is, and it's fine. And some people get their health back on track due to a plant-based diet. Perfectly, but in the long run, there's more research that shows that you need certain type of animal foods to be optimal when it comes to health in the long run than to a vegan diet. And sometimes research has its place as well, but common sense is there as well. Type in a Google box bad effects of a vegan diet, and you see loads of YouTube videos.
More risk of cancer, more risk of mood, depression, more health costs.
But the same goes with eating carnivore.
No, type it in. Bad results on the carnivore diet. And it's almost not there on the internet. Does that mean that a carnivore diet doesn't have bad effects? That's not what I'm saying, but I'm also trying to teach, or what we try to teach through our health concept is you can think for yourself a little bit as well. Not all research is absolutely true. The context of that research matters. Mm. Same goes for carnivore, same goes for vegan, for keto, for paleo, for epipaleo. Of course, there's a context to everything.
What we're standing for is, I think, there is no best diet. You have to look at your haplotype. You have to look, are you an athlete? There are so many things that,
But you're safe when you're rotating your diet, match it with the seasons. Don't eat 6 times a day only meat. Don't eat 6 times a day only fruit. I mean, just mix it up. And
listen to your body is the best
way to
go,
I think. If you have grown into eating GMO foods, cookies, that kind of crap, your body gets resistant of what is real.
Yeah.
I mean, your brain is highly saturated of bullshit. And if you come from a farm, the last podcast we discussed, I think, was Eugene Trufkin with Paul Check.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Eugene came from a biological organic farm, if I'm not mistaken. And in his bones, I mean, years of sunlight and organic food, the nutrition in his bones were so optimal that when he switched to a crappy diet, he didn't feel much in the beginning. Oh. Took a really long time for him to notice the bullshit.
So there we go again, it's context. I cannot say to you, if I don't have any information of your background, maybe lab results or something like that, that this is the best for you and this is the best for me. Mm-hmm. I have to know a little bit more about you.
What is leptin? So everybody knows what we're speaking of.
Yeah.
It's a hormone that's related to the metabolism of fat, but it's also a hormone that pays attention specifically to natural blue sunlight. It's in your subcutaneous fat, it's in your eye, and it's the controller of all the other hormones. So I always explain it to clients, see leptin as the lock on the door of your medicine cabin. All your other hormones are behind that door, and if leptin gives the signal that the environment is okay or to release certain type of hormones, then that signal comes from leptin. So leptin sensitivity, the ability to use lipids for fuel and sense the time through your skin and through your eye, that's one of the biggest tasks of what leptin does.
All right, so you have a leptin protocol?
Yeah.
Did you use for him? And how does that work, a leptin protocol?
I think it's not the day to describe a leptin protocol, I think, because I don't want people to use it at home with no context.
To be clear, the leptin reset is something that it comes from Jack Roos. We didn't invent it. Jack Roos is one of our teachers, one of many teachers we learn a lot from. So the way he always describes it is that it's a protocol of light without using light. It's a reset of your circadian rhythm through food. And there we go again, because food is more than just fuel. It brings information as well. And when you put somebody back on what he calls an epipaleo diet, so a lot of fish, a lot of omega-3s, less carbohydrates, you go into ketosis naturally, or you intermittent fasting naturally because you're saturated because of the proteins and because of more fuel from the fats. That's what a leptin reset is, and why we use that a lot on patients, because you need to get your hormonal balance back to grow to optimal health. And so the leptin reset is a tool to get, in certain contexts, to get people back on track, but it's not end all be all. You should eat like the leptin reset 12 months out of the year. It's just one tool, and that's what Milan was trying to say, and a bit cautious about, like, you don't need to tell everybody to go on the leptin.
Hey, sorry for interrupting. Battery of the microphone was up. I was dead. You were saying
technical problems.
Shit happens.
So yeah, we were saying that the leptin protocol is something we used on that basketball player. We use it on a couple other patients, but it's not end all be all. That's what we tried to say with leptin, but it's a big tool in our toolbox to get back, to get the hormonal balance back.
Mm. Yeah, and what's the effect of it? Better sleep, weight loss, a better hormone panel.
Body composition changes naturally without restricting calories.
Mm.
And something also that I find really interesting.
Thyroid problems.
Yeah, thyroid problems. Everything works better because then again, you need cholesterol to build all the hormones. Something else I was missing in the Game Changers documentary is the fact that a plant-based diet, it's really hard to get zinc in. And you need zinc for all kinds of metabolic functions. So that was something that was popping up in my head, like, yeah, okay, so.
Yeah, but then you could say, I'm going to use supplements.
Yeah, that could be the case.
So could we dive into the context of supplements?
I think that's of course. A good one.
Yeah.
Why would you supplement? I mean, of course, again, context. Let's say somebody is very, I eat vegan. And I come to you guys and say, guys, vegan is the way to go. I don't want to hurt animals. I cannot live about, if I eat meat, I want to eat vegan. Would you still help me?
Yeah, of course. I mean, if you have health problems, I mean, we would help him, right?
Yeah.
No, but I get the point. At one time, I had a girl from India, and because of her religious beliefs, she was a vegan, but she still wanted to work on her health. So that's one of the contexts when you say, okay, somebody is not willing, for whatever reason, to go off the plant-based diet.
Mm-hmm.
Where a supplement can be a really good tool. So then I would put her on a B12 supplement, on a zinc supplement, on an omega-3 supplement, because that's harder to get from plant-based food. Yeah, of course, you can get it from algae, but even then it's pretty hard. I would put her on some fish oil, but yeah, because of her religious belief, that's not an option. So in our opinion, to reach optimal health on a plant-based diet is really hard, especially when it comes to longevity. But yeah, we would do whatever we can for her. And when it comes to supplements, again, how's that supplement made? Is it organic? Do you know what they put in the supplement? Is it a bioavailable supplement? But in general, most of the supplements are not functioning well because it's missing. When you produce something, you got the forward circle, but when you produce something, there's also, let's say, garbage elements. Mm-hmm. And those garbage elements who exist in the process of making certain type of hormones is used in the body somewhere else as well. So you have a forward loop, the production, and then you got the garbage, and then that's what we call the feedback loop. But when something is already made and you put it in the body, it can have a function, but the forward loop is not working as hard because, yeah, it's already there. It's there in total most of the time. But the feedback loop is also not working. So in the long run, using supplements is not optimal for health. It can give people a boost when their health is really bad. And if you go for supplements, then we always advise to use organic supplements of a good quality. And what is a good quality supplement? I mean, we can do an all podcast on that.
Yeah, we're going to discuss some supplements for Avmax in the future.
Yeah.
Are you looking for any supplements to boost your health? Because you want to restore, maintain, or achieve optimal health? Our friends at Ergomax from the Netherlands got you covered. From deuterium depleted water, enzymes and probiotics to magnesium and vitamin C. It is your one-stop shop for supplements. I know the owners and I know they care about quality and they themselves are an example of healthy human beings. And three of my previous guest experts are very happy with their products. They use them personal and for their patients as well. I'm talking about mitochondrial expert Thomas van Doorn, clinical psycho-neuroimmunologist Ruud Elvers, and biological dentist Merlon van Ravenstein. If they would not approve, I would not be sharing Ergomax. Thomas, Ruud and Merlon helped me big time achieving a more optimal form of health in my life. So let me help you helping yourself. Get your supplements at Ergomax and feel free to send me your experience with their products. You'll find the link in the description and the show notes. Now, back to the episode.
Yeah, that will be fun because the context of supplements is so big because the production varies from factory to factory, from country to country, even sometimes from region to region. Mm-hmm. Which source materials do they use? So supplements can be a help. Is it something I would rely on or I want my clients to rely on? Absolutely not. But then again, it's a tool in the toolbox.
So somebody could discover this by just simply doing a blood test in month X and month I.
Yeah. It could be in every 2 months, every 3 months. Personally, we do it every 8 weeks with the clients.
And do you have a tip for somebody? Maybe you know a nice YouTube video where they could get nice inside knowledge on how to read their own blood results, or would you say just go to a specialist like one of yourself?
Yeah, I would do that because that's a funny question you ask me, because a lot of people are asking that. I get my lab work back from the doctor and I'm average, but yeah. I feel like shit.
Yeah.
I say, okay, look around. Okay. Yeah, look around you. I mean, do you want to be average? And all those people say, no, I don't want to be average because everybody looks sick and tired at my work or in my gym or where they at. I say, okay, so you want to be at the top 25% of the normal ranges, but in some ways the health declines every 10 years when it comes to certain types, for example, blood sugar. It's way higher now in general than it was 60 years back. So the standards shift with the average as well. So if the all average gets sick or less optimal, then you become less optimal as well, but the blood work says, I'm average, but the average people are sick or not feeling well or not feeling optimal. So
do you guys have a baseline for what is optimal or in the upper 25%?
Yeah, upper 25% is optimal of what is normal. Yeah. So then you're okay. But do we have standards for this has to be like this or this has to be like that? No, but maybe with the vitamin D, we don't want you under 60, 65 millimol.
Minimal, I think 70, 75.
Yeah.
Right.
Yep. So, but that also depends on your context.
In winter.
In winter time. Yeah. And in the summertime, we want you up above 100 millimol to be sure.
Yeah. And in blood results, we see from a lot of our patients, they have a lot of magnesium deficiency because of the indoor living they do.
If there's one supplement, I think that is not hurting the general population, I think it would be a good quality magnesium supplement because we have so much stress in our environment. Light pollution is a big one. Non-organic food, sound pollution, air pollution,
stress, a lot of sports, indoor sporting.
Yeah, a mismatch in the circadian rhythms, and that depletes magnesium, and magnesium is a really important mineral that you use for like over 300 processes in the human cell. Yeah. So yeah, magnesium, that would be.
I know this because of my study, and also because of festivals. If you use ecstasy, for instance, magnesium is very nice. You don't get this incredible tension in your jaws. But if you get the cheap ones at Kruidvat in the Netherlands, that you get a magnesium oxide, which is pure. How do you call that stuff where you go to the loo and you just keep on crapping?
Oh, the diarrhea, you mean? Or
yeah, how do you call that stuff so you can go to the toilet very easy, that gene too?
Ah, okay, I know what you mean, but I don't know the
name of it.
Yeah, lactate.
Yeah, like, so
it's not lactate.
No?
Lactate.
Oh, I don't know in English, but I get the
but
point.
But that stuff. So the magnesium oxide, for instance, is pure crap.
Yeah.
What is a form of magnesium that you would highly advise to take?
You want to elaborate on that?
Malate, yeah.
Yeah, magnesium malate. Orotate.
Taurate.
Yeah, that would be three.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then when you go to other ones... Hey, there you go. That's what the podcast is about. It depends, you know. If we get a quarter for every time we say context, then...
All right.
Yeah, so, I want to tell...
Oh, you
want to
add something to that?
Patients, it's when you buy a supplement, buy a good supplement, because otherwise you are hurting your body. And even your doctor tells you that a supplement from Atos is... the same as a very expensive supplement. It's not true. No,
you have to go to a specialist and put some time and energy to figure out which supplements are a better quality than other ones. And that's the same with food as well.
Yeah, so we could say Atos has the same level of stuff as Walmart, just to make it a bit more for the rest of the world.
Yeah, probably.
Or we have to ask Jack Cruz or Paul Check.
Or worse. I've seen some labels of some supplements there, and I'm not a big fan.
No. So
rapeseed oil and something.
Get organic supplementation as well if you go for supplements,
and please go to a specialist. If you're buying something, you're already spending money, so make sure you spend a little bit more money to buy a consult of any number of specialists. So good advice, because I think investing in your health...
It's the best investment
there is. You get a frame of reference, and then you can do your own research.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, and you've also black holes, so you can't know everything.
Yeah. And then it's just a way of experiencing, trying it out for yourself.
Yeah.
Maybe do it. If you're a biohacker and you really want to get to know yourself, you do blood research.
Yeah. And give yourself a couple of years to know your body well. You can say...
It's the same like getting by in life and know what works for you, your body, and treating your body. It's also a learning process, and it goes with ups and downs, but... Yeah, I mean, it's always good to invest time in that, because you have to work with your body, you have to work with your brain, and we all know that if you're feeling well, more energized, life is easier, and you enjoy life more than when you're having health problems all the time. And investing in your health is...
All right, next one. The Wim Hof Method.
Yeah. Nice.
Give me some context.
it's nice. I think he helps people to focus on breathing a lot. So that's good, because people are not conscious about breathing. And if you're sitting on your work all the time, or you're not out in nature that much, he's also doing his breathing work always out in nature. So that's good, because you got natural light there.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of the most important things for health. No, it is the most important thing for health, is our opinion, getting natural light. But
And I think Wim Hof is very, very great. The whole world is talking about him. And I think many, many, many people do way better things with his mindset, with cold showers. So I think his impact on the world is good.
Mm,
very, absolutely. Very good. Because I have heard talk about I'm taking cold showers, about Since Wim Hof told me, and I think it's very good for the body to give a quick stress response to the body to do some kind of things. But I don't think the podcast is about the good things about Wim Hof. You want to talk about the skin problems?
Well, there are good things, and I want to discuss them both. I
mean, yeah, of course. Yeah.
I mean, that Wim Hof is here, especially that he's getting so huge in this world. I think it's great for human consciousness because he's waking up a part of us.
Yeah, that's perfectly. The context I'm personally missing with the Wim Hof method is that you have to be leptin sensitive, so you have to be able to burn lipids for fuel to protect yourself from extreme cold. Mm. So let's say you go to in an ice bath. That's a big stressor, and that big stressor can give you tremendous benefits for that specific moment or for a week after. But if you're doing Wim Hof method, let's say every day, and you go every day into an ice bath, or let's make it like 3 times a week, if you're not leptin sensitive, meaning that the liver is not working properly, then it's the stressor is too big. The body cannot handle the stressor, and your health declines in the long run.
Mm-hmm.
So I did a podcast with a Wim Hof instructor, or
Bart Pronk.
Yeah, he's one of the co-founders, if I'm not mistaken, of the Wim Hof method. He's a really experienced guy, and he was saying to me like, yeah, but a lot of Wim Hof practitioners have sometimes a little bit problems with the skin. The stressor is really big, and that stressor, if you do that chronically, then it's too hard on the body, especially for the collagen in the body. It's a little bit too technical to go into it now, but also with the Wim Hof method, don't do it 12 months a year. In the winter, when it is cold outside and the temperature drops, the UV content drops, then it's a perfect tool. But do you need to do it to get the benefits out of the Wim Hof method at 3 degrees Celsius or 4 degrees Celsius? No. Everything on the body temperature is already giving a small benefit. And some research says that 12 degrees Celsius is the optimal range. So that's 55 Fahrenheit is the optimal range for the body, that it's a positive stressor, but you're not declining your health in the long run. Mm. So,
yeah, but I think the skin problems are not from the cold and the breathing. I think there's a lot of more that can cause skin problems. I think the leaky gut or something, it's not about the cold and
yeah, it could
breathing.
Be about the cold because let's say your diet is not in order and you're eating way too much omega 6 compared to omega 3 when mm-hmm. you're coming in the cold, then it causes skin problems as well. Mm-hmm. Could cause skin problems. So no, it's not 100% that Wim Hof is gonna get you skin problems. That's not what I was trying to say. But what I do know is that a lot of people who are doing Wim Hof and doing it hardcore, so like multiple times a week, experience skin problems, and they don't all have the same template. So there is a relation. Maybe we can go into it later because it's pretty pretty technical.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and when you have a chronic stress, it's not good for the body to do chronic stress again. And I think when our ancestors back in the days were not sitting in the cold for
3 or 4 hours.
No.
I don't think here, but we could you're doing an ayahuasca ceremony
yes.
soon. Maybe
yeah.
we can go back in time.
Yeah, and I'm not saying Wim Hof is saying to everybody that you should be in the cold for 3 or 4 hours. That's not what they're saying. That's not in general.
No.
That's why we love Wim Hof method, because in general they're saying cold is really good tool in the toolbox, and
yeah. we're also using it with our clients. So we're
cold therapy, absolutely.
Yeah. We are absolutely pro.
Yeah.
But
depending on the context again,
yeah.
if you're a haplotype, if you're from Indonesia,
yeah.
then the body you got like certain type of SNPs or SNAPs in your haplotype, in your DNA, and you don't do that well. You're not able to switch to burning fats that easy. It takes you a little bit more time, and when you're doing cold. But for us, we have a Northern European haplotype with a white skin, then it's, for us it's easier because we have a bigger change in the seasons. In Indonesia or around the equator is more or less the same. Even there you got seasons, of course, but the season changes are bigger here, so we are adapting to that.
Yeah, right. That's one of the things. We are not describing protocols, we are describing at one patient's one intervention, because when you work with protocols, you're not giving the patients the best
treatment.
Our
context of our environment is so different now these days. I've given this example 100 times. Back in the day, we didn't have to teach people or animals how to live, what to eat. There was no choice. The light environment was there. Maybe you had some fire. The food was from your environment. But now two guys from Indonesia can have a completely different environment. One is working outside. One is working inside. One is only eating fast food. One is eating organic. One is working out at 11 at night, one is working out outside. So the context of people is changing so easily because of modern lights and supermarkets and stuff like that. So we cannot say this works for everybody. Mm-hmm. The one thing that works for everybody is reconnect with nature. I mean, we're a product of nature, and sometimes we forget that. We think because we have a prefrontal cortex that we're not an animal, but we're also an animal, and we got 3.8 billion years of evolution, and in that evolution one thing was always present, that was nature. For example, our human cells are adapted to gravity because gravity was always on Earth. We're adapted to sunlight because sunlight was always there. We are adapted, or we're using water because water was always there. Depending on the region and the amount and the availability changes, but we're using those natural laws, basically, and we try to go around those laws, but those laws are in our DNA, are in our evolution, and if you don't respect the natural laws, then it's not optimal for health, or it makes you sicker fast. And that's what we try to teach at Your Health Concept. It's your responsibility, it's your health. We have a concept for it, and that concept is different in every person, but one thing we always try to use in that protocol or in your intervention, in your one-on-one coaching, is respect nature. And some people say that's hippie and that's flowerish and whoa. Well, no, that's just basic science. Yeah, I mean, it's just physics. Gravity is just physics. There's not hippie flowery about it. Sunlight, I mean, that's not hippie or weird or not.
Yeah, to endorse it, I just read Mind to Matter by Dawson Church, because of the episode he did with Paul Check. And one of the things he described, that he described the research from NASA and I forgot the other names, the researcher's name, but they found out that when you pinpoint meridians, that with the solar flare activity they measured with NASA, they could their meridians were on the same energy of the frequency as the sun flares. And I also remember research where they showed Ozzie the Iceman. I think they found him in the Alps.
I know. Europe. I didn't know exactly where they found him, but I read something.
He had some. He was much older than you and I.
Oh yeah.
And he would have like these crosses on his meridians. So back in the days, people already knew how to use meridians and.
Yeah, of course, man. We think that we are so sophisticated and we're super modern human. Back in the days in Egypt, they made the top of the pyramid, they put gold on it because the Egyptians knew that red light gets reflected better by gold. And then all the slaves had to sit around the pyramids at a certain time when the red light in the sun was the highest. That reflected from the gold, and then it was better aimed at the slave, so their production goes up, their health goes up, their bones get stronger as well. So nature and the power of nature for human health.
You experience stress, tension, trauma, and you want to learn how to deal with this yourself. Well, then this tool is for you. And I'm talking about tension and trauma release exercises, also known as TRE. And in my 9-year healing journey, this has become one of my absolute favorites that I still use today, every day. And it's a very simple yet innovative series of exercises that assist the body in releasing deep muscular patterns of stress, tension and trauma. Created by Dr. David Buscelli, PhD. Now, TRE safely activates a natural reflex mechanism of shaking or vibrating that releases muscular tension, calming down the nervous system. When this muscular shaking, vibrating mechanism is activated in a safe and controlled environment, then the body is encouraged to return back to a state of balance.
And the beauty is, it is like learning how to drive a bike, so you only need to learn it once. And all my viewers and listeners get a 25% discount. So use the code ID25 at the checkout and enjoy the rest of this interview.
Yeah, I mean, look at Chinese medicine. I mean, they can read your organs by a heartbeat. I mean, yeah, humans were, back in the days, were pretty smart about health as well.
Yeah.
Maybe even smarter than now, because now we're so much focused on certain type of evidence, and we forget all the time that evidence is not, in a lot of cases, it's not objective.
Yeah, and on that note, I really want to quote Paul Check: "Don't let your schooling get in the way of your
education." Yeah, he's also really a good health teacher, Paul Check. We learned a lot from him, from his courses, from his books, from
his podcast.
Yes, podcast also. Yeah, he gives a lot of good information.
I think he is one of the best holistic coaches in the world.
He's so
overall.
Yeah, he puts so much attention on, and that's what we try to do at Your Health Concept. We're not on the level of Paul Check by any means. I mean, that guy has so much experience, but he's a good example that there's context, but that there are also a lot of pillars that make health. I mean, moving and eating, sleeping, hydration, but also emotional health and spirituality. What happened there? Spirituality again. He's a really good source of good information.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
All right, next one. We covered veganism, of course. Vegetarian. Eating a vegetarian diet. Place in the context.
I think you missed the EPA and DHA in it, and B12. Yeah, you can B12 from raw cow milk. So maybe you can get vitamin B12, but I think in the modern world now you get a more inflammation. Your inflammation levels are higher from food, from the toxins, from living indoors.
So blue light.
I think DHA, getting DHA from fish, not from algae, are essential. Yeah. So I think.
So you're missing that.
It's not optimal. We are standing for optimal, and I think it's not optimal.
But is it? For instance, I think Weston A. Price also discovered a diet in. I'm not sure if it was Australia, but he discovered a tribe of people that were living in the land. And just a couple of miles further down the coast, they ate lots of fish.
Yeah.
But this tribe of people that ate mostly plant-based, they thrived. But then again, the people who lived near the coast, they also thrived. And then you get a context of evolution of years of a tribe that is used to eating plant-based,
mm-hmm.
and here you have a tribe that is eating fish.
But it depends on where you live, because now when you have ancestors from the Nordic Eastern, you can't. We were not evolved when we did not eat animal parts.
And you can survive, or you can even thrive on a plant-based diet in that context, in that area, with certain type of sun, and the nutrient density was way better than now. Now, a plant-based diet is not optimal because we have fake light and a lot of stress, air pollution, all the types of stressors that are now here that tribe didn't have. So the context of modern humans now is completely different.
Yeah.
I mean, we're recording a podcast here. They didn't do that like 400 or 500 years ago, and all the stress and everything that comes with it.
I think when you have a lot of artificial light, you can do a vegetarian diet.
No. When you have so much artificial light as a normal average human person has, it is such a big stressor where not a lot of people are aware of that it depletes you from all kinds of vital minerals, and it ruins up the system. The body clock starts guessing, and
but
we are creating chaos by not living under the sun.
But it takes a lot of years to feel it, because the most of the people are feeling the pros in the coming years, in the 2 years, 3 years, but mostly after 7 years, they are feeling less good and have a depression, have mood swings.
Yeah, health is a marathon and diets are sprints.
Yeah.
And sometimes you can have a really good sprint, but it doesn't mean that you're going to win the marathon. And optimal health is looked, I look at it as a marathon. And it's also not to bash on people or to bash on diets. It's just being healthy in this environment gets more complicated on one end. You can still easily get it or reach it. And there's so much information out there. There's so many half-truths, except for instead the game changers. And those half-truths always create problems in the long run. And we are so focused on now, on being popular now, or performing now, or doing this now, everything. A friend of us, Ruud Elvers, who you did a podcast with, says the modern human now is already too late. That's the mindset of the people. But that's not how it works in nature. That's not how it works with nature's laws. And that's not how your body works, and health, and especially optimal health, is not working that way. So, yeah, it's pretty hard. It's hard work to be optimal these days. And before, you didn't have to think that much about it.
So how optimal are you guys?
Ooh, that's a good question.
I think you have good days and you have... but I think all my days are like from 7 to 9. Yeah, I have no really, really, really bad days that I'm feeling that bad. And in this winter, I took a vacation to Mexico to meet Jack Cruz.
How much wine does he drink?
He likes his wine, sir. Yeah.
And I didn't have a really bad day this winter, no. And when I compare it with years ago, when I missed all this information and didn't do my biohacks, didn't know how to how to work with my body instead of working against my body. So I'm pretty.
But how do you know when
now
you're having a good day or a bad day? How is it for,
how do you know?
For you?
Headaches, sleeping problems, weight problems, mood problems. Yeah, can I go on?
Mental clarity. When I speak for myself, I always test it on how do I wake up? Do I feel rested? Do I feel energized? That's one of the things I'm always looking at. The second thing is, how is my mood? Are there things that normally I don't mind, and now I really mind them? I don't have energy to do them, or I don't want to do them. Is it 1 day a week? Is it 2 days a week? Is it 3 days a week? So when I speak for myself, I have no health issues at all. I check my labs every 2, sometimes 3 months, depending on the season. I'm always energized when I wake up.
I'm always asking him why he's doing labs, because he's always feeling good. So why are you doing labs?
Yeah, because now these days, feeling good is a pretty big marker, but it's not the only marker anymore. Sometimes stuff, when you're feeling good, for example, you're doing a sprint and you're feeling good on a vegan diet, your blood work shows something completely different, because the context is so easy to change now these days, and that can be good, but it can also be bad. Mm-hmm. So I'm always doing labs because of the fact that...
And you're testing a lot, so...
Yeah, I'm testing all, everything we talked about, I tested myself. So vegan, carnivore, paleo, keto diet, cold therapy in ice baths for days in a row, weeks in a row, months in a row, cold showers for years, blocking blue light, infrared A lamps, B lamps. I try everything. I want to be somebody who goes through the process every time with mental coaching. Go to other coaches. I read books all the time. Yeah, it's something. It's a journey. Being healthy, it's a journey, and I'm becoming in love with that journey and want to share the things that I've learned through studies, research, but also my own experience, and try to help other people with that to feel as optimal as I feel. And if is that optimal? I don't know if that's optimal, but I feel energized, alive, I'm having fun, I can work out whenever I want, I can do what I want, I always sleep in the summer 8 hours, in the winter always 10 hours.
I think what's optimal for our clients is when I have a triact with a patient and he tells me at the end, my whole life changed. Yeah, I have a better family life, a better love life, a better connection with myself, with friends. I think, I changed his or her days. Every day, and hopefully in the coming future.
And then you become closer to optimal.
Yeah.
Right. So in the previous podcast, we discussed your history and with your sister, for instance, and that was a big part in the nudging of Thomas becoming the person he is today.
Yeah, absolutely.
Could you maybe give an explanation of why you got into health?
Yeah, so I think I told a couple of minutes ago, because I had health problems and I was very interested in food and in health also, but I had health problems. I could not sleep, I had a lot of stress, rheumatoid problems with stress, overthinking, maybe. You can relate. Sleeping problems, mood problems.
There was a period you had a couple headaches as well. On the same time, every time, for weeks or months.
Yeah, for weeks or months. Very, very heavy headaches. And I am a very curious person. When I do something, I want to do it the best. I want to know the best. Mm-hmm. When you know better, you do better. I love to read, so I read for years. I think I wrote a lot of books, and I want to read more books in the coming years. And so I came on all the different paths, from orthomolecular to Paul Check to Jack Cruz to so many things that makes a full circle. I think I'm where we are now. We know, we do the best we know, but maybe another year we have more information and we do other things.
That's why it's called your health concept. Yeah. It's a concept for now and it's not a fixed thing. But I think you're forgetting the biggest point. I mean, you're a dentist. I mean, you were always telling me, like, when you're 12, 13 years old, you wanna be in healthcare and help people. So
yeah, and
that's a big thing.
I work in dentistry, in medicine, so I have a medical background, and what I see there is using protocols, not looking at the whole body, looking at some points of
isolated
the body.
Isolated elements all the time.
Isolated elements. Yeah. When someone come to me with one problem and say, yeah, I see four dentists and now you're telling me this and I didn't heard of it. We could fix the problem in like 30 minutes or it's all about information. Sometimes when someone has a problem in his mouth, it's not from his mouth, it's from his knee or some other places. I think holistic medicine, what we are doing is the whole body, and that's what's inspiring me. And now I can help people for real and not treating symptoms. I am really helping someone, and that's what's making me very happy.
Mm. So what are things that you're struggling right now with at the moment?
When it comes to health?
Yeah.
Related issues?
Or something that you really want to improve?
For me, it's time. I want more time. That's one of the things we ask patients. how important is optimal health for you? How many times, how many hours a day do you want to spend on your health? Mm-hmm. We want to spend a lot of time on our health because it's very important for us, and we know how we feel. Now we feel healthy, and now it's very important for us to feel healthy. But we also want things like telling the world, and that costs a lot of time, and sitting at your computer and calling with people and describing blogs and writing blogs are costs time. And you can spend time in nature and spend time with family, but we also want to tell the world and tell what we
know. Keeping the balance between working on your own health or staying healthy and sacrifice your time to help somebody else. I think that's something.
Spreading the word.
Yeah, spreading the word, try to help people, help clients, help patients. I mean, we're living in a certain type of modern environment, and in our own practice, we try to do the best we can to work with people outside, or don't have blue lights and fake lights, or having a lot of red lights, and eating organic template, and only going to restaurants where we know the quality is good. But now in this modern world, you cannot escape all the time if you want to work. I mean, we're sitting here now, and we're having a big discussion about, yeah, I want my blue blockers on, yeah, but then we don't see your face. But actually, I don't give a lot about my face. I mean, I want to protect my eyes, yeah, but then the whole video goes to shit. Okay, so let's do it for one. So that's a small example of the things you're dealing with every day. And of course, you don't have to be paranoia about it. I mean, I know how to, the things that are hurting me now, to offset that. But that's something that's really a challenge to work.
And how do you feel about the 80-20 rule? Because we, for instance, we ate some shawarma last week.
Yeah, of course,
and,
yeah. So personally, I don't go for the 80-20 rule. Personally, I try to go for the 95-5 rule. And one of my guilty pleasures is, I like to eat a shawarma sandwich. And then I always try to go to, I know one shawarma where he has organic lamb meat. Nice. So when I order something, I go there.
Where is it?
That's in Amsterdam.
Oh, with the...
At the Hoofddorpplein is called. Oh, okay. Yeah.
This is not interesting for people.
Maybe it is for boys.
Yeah, maybe for a foreigner tourist when you come to the land, go to the Hoofddorpplein and get that organic farm. Yeah.
But I think then food is your weak spot. And for me, my weak spot is my profession. So with food, I think I go 100%. And with my job, I have to do other things like 200%, because otherwise I can do my profession and being healthy.
Mm. Yeah, so so again, balancing it out. But the 80-20 rule, I try to avoid that and try to do it. So when you eat the shawarma, don't eat bread, for example, or eat it just once or twice a year, because
but I think people don't understand what the choices we make are of 24 hours. We don't eat at tank stations or at airplanes.
But when we fly, then we fast. We don't eat something out of the airport.
Because the quality is so bad.
Very interesting topic, fasting. I just started fasting, doing a 36, 40-hour fast. And intermittent fasting, of course, is very popular.
Yeah, it's very popular, And there's a lot of research out there that shows that it has tremendous health benefits. But even then, there's a context as well. How long should you fast? Is it a dry fast, so only air, so no water, no food? Is it the only food fast? Do you do it 16 hours, 20 hours, 22, prolonged fast?
Are you
fast,
a woman? Are you... are you a man? Do you have stress problems? Do you have cortisol problems? I don't think it's a good idea when you are coming from a burnout and you do some intermittent fasting.
Yeah, because Ruud was coming for a meeting last week, and when I told him I was doing a 36-hour fast, and not eating. He also spoke about it's very dangerous if you are producing lots of ketones and sitting in a very EMF-rich environment.
Yeah, because the oxygen tension drops in an environment where there's a lot of electromagnetic fields. So to use the ketones as fuel, you need more oxygen than when you're on when you're using sugar. When you're fasting, you're also using sugar as a fuel source, and the body will always make sure that it gets a little bit of sugar to work on.
So yeah, you get sugar from your bones when you're moving. Your bones and your muscles are releasing sugar.
Yeah, of course. But when you're doing a ketogenic diet, for example, a lot of people are always worried that you're burning muscle, and that's not the case, because the body protects itself from burning muscle because you need the muscle to survive. But your question was, if I'm not mistaken, that why is it more dangerous in an EMF, a lot of EMF environment like a studio like this, what's your workplace, to have a lot of ketones, because you're sitting, you're not moving, so you don't using a lot of oxygen, and the oxygen tension in that building, in all buildings, but especially in a building where there's a lot of EMF, that level of oxygen is lower, and you need a lot of oxygen to have the optimal benefits from burning ketones as a fuel source. So I think, I mean, that's my guess, that why Ruud was saying that.
Yeah, and let's say intermittent fasting. I think intermittent fasting is more popular and it's more easy to do for people, because when I now tell friends, in my WhatsApp groups, you know, that he's not eating meat anymore and he's not doing that, and then you have Matthijs, he's not eating at all. But intermittent fasting, of course, is I think a very nice introduction to fasting, and if I'm not mistaken, some friends of mine are doing it as well. What are the risks of intermittent fasting, and what kind of variables you want to keep in mind when you start doing something like that? So, for instance, EMF already plays a role.
Yeah, so electromagnetic fields dehydrate you. So having your phone in your pocket, having your laptop on your lap, sleeping to a Wi-Fi router, being in a studio where there's all kinds of EMF.
So you're in a big microwave.
You're in a big microwave.
The frequency is just like in a microwave, and it vaporizes the hydrogen levels.
Yeah, absolutely. So for example, when you're fasting, you get rid of some bad stuff as well. The digestive tract gets a little bit more rest, and especially when you're fasting a little bit longer, autophagy starts to work harder, or is more at the surface than when you're eating all the time. And for autophagy to clean out all the bad cells and clean out all the toxins, you need to be hydrated. And the fact that you're drinking a lot of water helps to be hydrated better, but it doesn't mean that the cells are hydrated. That's there are a lot of variables who are come into play if you're hydrated, yes or no. So in an electromagnetic field environment, your cells become less hydrated, and if you're fasting, then 36 hours, for example, it can be a bigger stressor on the body to push the toxins out. Now, 36 hours is pretty moderate, and that's okay. I wouldn't recommend to start there. I would always recommend to start with 1 day of fasting, 1 day off, 1 day of fasting, and do it for 16 hours, no food, 8 hours food, and then let the body get used to it. And then we go again. You can do all this, and because a lot of people are fasting and then also depleting carbohydrates, but are you leptin sensitive? And it's not possible to be leptin sensitive in an environment where there's blue light all the time. So there comes a lot at play at fasting, but in general fasting, do you think there was a refrigerator in nature 500 years back? I mean, having no food or no water for a certain amount of time is not gonna kill you, or is not bad. Research shows it's healthy for you, but what's your context? Where are you coming from? For example, some cancer patients fast before they go into chemotherapy, and it's proven that that gives them a benefit to get better results from the chemo. So it's, again, depending on the context, can you start with a 16-8 fasting period? Yeah, absolutely, you can do it. When you won't have to prepare anything.
And it makes you more flexible. People are not flexible at the moment because you're always eating six times a day, and they are like, when they get, they don't get food because they're always on the sugar train, always on the Krebs cycle, and you can't get fat, you can't burn fat when you're always using the sugar train. And I think it's good for people to be more flexible, train your mitochondria to go without food. Mm-hmm. When you can test yourself if you're flexible when you eat like one or two times a day, and that then it's okay. You can eat for three times a day, but it has to be possible to eat one or two times a day.
And your energy levels shouldn't drop big. Yeah. And you should be flexible on a metabolic way, so your cells should be able to swim to go without food and produce their own energy by maybe using your stored fat, for example, or produce energy in different ways. By
otherwise, you're always using your glycogen. And
I really noticed when I started doing this, I think with one day off eating, one day off.
But what's the goal? You have a lot of. I see some girls with eating problems, and then I think it's not always a good idea to go for fasting because you can introduce other kinds of problems. You can make it worse. Mm. You have to look deep into a person's and deep into yourself, and what are my goals for it?
Yeah, how's your mental flexibility? Yeah. Are you doing it because you're not happy with yourself? Then I would not recommend it. Are you doing it to lose some weight and have guidance from a coach who's experienced? Then it's already a lot better. But are you doing it to starve yourself because you think you're way too fat, but you look normal and you're not having, you're not obese? So that's really important when it comes to fasting as well. Mm-hmm. Fasting is not just working on the physiology of things, it's also a holistic tool.
And what's another important thing is the bio clock, the circadian rhythm. I think it's better for your circadian rhythm to eat breakfast and stop earlier at the day with eating. Don't eat after dark instead of eating at 1 o'clock and go on till 9 o'clock.
Yeah, a lot of people who are fasting are skipping breakfast.
Yeah.
Mm. And that's not always optimal.
Yeah.
And I always use an analogy, pretty simple. And of course, it's more complex, but it drives the message home pretty nicely, I think. If you're having a car and you're using that car always in the first gear, always on the highway, in the city, always, your car burns out faster. So let's say only eating carbohydrates and sugars, what nobody does because everybody eats meat, but let's say that's the case. You're using your human car always in gear one, and then it wears out a lot faster, and then that's not optimal. You have to be able to switch gears with your metabolic flexibility, with your energy production as well. Mm-hmm. So, and that's why fasting comes into play. It can help you to switch to different gears and look at that sixth gear. Is it still there? Is it still working? Is it still helping me if I need it? So that's how I look at intermittent fasting. Mm. It's just, and that same goes with seasonal eating, ketogenic or more paleo style. It's just switching gears, and a car has a lot of gears, and we are highly complex machinery, and we have a lot of gears, and those gears you can switch it by fuel, by food. But the other thing I want to tell people always, food is just a small part of switching gears. Nature's laws are a way stronger field that switch your gears. The sun, gravity, electromagnetic fields naturally, but now these days also not naturally. So don't focus on food that much. I know it's easy, I know it's fun to eat because Yeah, everybody likes to eat. I like to eat as well.
Yeah, and you have to eat, so you can better eat optimal than mm-hmm.
you can
eat crap.
Better eat optimal. So there is a place for food, but it's small one.
Yeah. What was your record of not eating?
I wouldn't say a record, but I did. I test always everything. So,
but I think it's not the good thing to tell because
you were gonna say
that. Now we're gonna. It's the same as my weight is 75 kilos.
Yeah, and I drive a Ferrari. My dick is.
Yeah, yeah. And we are all healthy and into the mitochondrial game. Mm. And maybe people who are listening to this are new in it and are shaking like when they are not eating for 3 hours. I think look at where you're starting. Start low. Start with skipping lunch and some kind of things, and not striving to reach.
I'm a pretty experienced fast. Yeah. I've been already for 5-6 years, so I go certain days without food or water.
And he is healthy, so he can do that.
And I'm doing it for the health benefits and not for being tough. Yeah, I fasted for an X amount of days. Mm. So
and listen to your body. That's the whole thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because when it's you don't feel well, don't go further.
It's not the case like, oh, I drink one night the wine with my friends. I go into a fast for 5 days to offset that. No, that's not how we're looking at health. Mm. But yeah, again and again, I cannot say this stuff enough. I mean, don't focus that much on food.
Are you looking for any supplements to boost your health? Because you want to restore, maintain, or achieve optimal health? Our friends at Ergomax from the Netherlands got you covered. From deuterium depleted water, enzymes, and probiotics to magnesium and vitamin C, it is your one-stop shop for supplements. I know the owners, and I know they care about quality, and they themselves are an example of healthy human beings. And three of my previous guest experts are very happy with their products. They use them personal and for their patients as well. I'm talking about mitochondrial expert Thomas van Doorn, clinical psycho-neuroimmunologist Ruud Elvers, and biological dentist Merlon van Ravenstein. If they would not approve, I would not be sharing Ergomax. Thomas, Ruud and Merlon helped me big time achieving a more optimal form of health in my life. So let me help you helping yourself. Get your supplements at Ergomax and feel free to send me your experience with their products. You'll find the link in the description and the show notes. Now, back to the episode.
All right, let's dive into science. Because of course, and now we are speaking about the lesser things about, let's say, a diet or a method. But how does one find his or her own way in the field of science? And I think Paul Cech always describes, or he quotes Carl Jung, if I'm not mistaken, about...
Yeah, he does that a lot, quoting Carl.
Yeah, there's science here, there's science there, now you have to grow up. Now you have to grow up. Now you have to make up your own mind, and that's something that I'm also have been struggling with lately. But then now, lately I did a bit of research on mitochondrial stress of 3 and 4G, and stress it puts on the cell membranes. And then I thought, holy shit, this is not making me a very happy person today, and also not tomorrow and the day after that. Because you become aware of risks. But how would you advise somebody into the realm of science? How to make up your mind? How do you learn somebody? How did you learn that?
That's a tough one. That's a journey that's really tough. So what I personally did, I talked a lot with Bart Kay. Bart Kay is he calls himself the science watchdog. He's literally an expert who teaches you to read science. So where's the money coming from? How is the investigation set up? Is it focused on short term? Is it focused on long term? So that's a process on itself, and that goes with a lot of mistakes. Sometimes you read something, you think, this makes sense, and then you find out. So the best thing is your own experience and listen to people who have a big track record, but also look healthy. So for example, you can be a perfect scientist and you have like all kinds of PhDs and you can have all kinds of awards. But if you're talking about health and that person on itself doesn't look healthy to you, and what I mean with healthy is like he doesn't look healthy on a long period of time. So, oh no, you look tired, you're not healthy. No, that's not what I'm meaning. He's extremely obese, or he's having a lot of problems with his energy, or a lot of mood swings. And
but maybe you cannot see that. I mean, lots of in these days, when you see a bodybuilder, you say, "Oh, that's a fit person."
Yeah, I don't agree that's on that too, person. Because when we see someone with a six-pack, exactly. Oh, I want him as a personal trainer because
I mean, I think for instance, the people who are filming right now, they couldn't spot adrenal fatigue in the eyes of somebody.
No.
For chronic stress response in the face with somebody,
or an mind thing.
I know, but you have to start somewhere.
Yeah, so, that's true.
So you have to start somewhere. So if somebody's talking about health, so let's make it more simple.
I think you have to think yourself. Don't rely on somebody else.
But
you
that's
have
the question:
to
how do you learn to think for yourself, right?
In a sense.
So make it easy if you have a personal trainer who is extremely obese. He's going to train you and he's going to give you information about food. Then the chances are that the information he's giving you, he didn't walk that path himself. So he didn't experience to change his diet or to go from obese to slim again. So that's something where you can start. Is it end all be all? No, somebody who's obese can have a lot of knowledge,
but didn't understand the leptin protocol,
for example, or didn't have the time, or was not willing to make the time to put it on themselves. But then again, you're learning from somebody who has a different mindset than you, because you are looking for somebody who has a mindset. Back in the day, we didn't talk about research. We go to elderly, right?
Mm-hmm.
They had a lot of experience, and they want the best for you, for their tribe in most cases. Now we have money, researchers, power and stuff like that. So it's really hard. So if you ask me, there's not one way. You have to experience it and use a lot of common sense.
Yeah, but you can learn how to read articles, and because I was at university, and there I learned how to read articles, writing articles. Write an article by myself, so I know what are the holes and where to look at. So I think that's easier to scan an article and know how it is, because you can get your outcome how you want it. You can influence the article yourself.
No, but that's absolutely the case. But with a lot of big researchers, people are trained into a dogma. The research has to be this way, and you have to think about it this way. So an outcome, on one hand, the outcome cannot be made up and, oh, we want to write this. But on the other hand, is everybody is thinking that way, and everybody acts a certain type of way, then a certain type of outcome that people wish or hope for is more likely to happen as well. So me personally, I always go to people who have a lot of experience, but still tell you that they don't know all, and that it's just research is just it's looking at a certain context at a certain time at a certain moment, and it has a certain outcome. But we're always trying to look, okay, it has to be black or white. Mm-hmm. It has to be fixed. Nothing in nature is fixed. You have seasonal changes. A tree is not a tree. He grows and all kinds of things happen. So a research is just telling you something about a certain type of moment that we measure that in time. Yeah. So I don't know if that answers the question.
But you mentioned Bartke. I think that's a very nice one. If you have somebody like that to teach you a bit about how does one read science, and of course a very important topic, which I'm also a very big advocate of, is go to people who are what they say they are. And I've been treated by a dozen of physiotherapists who had duck feet, who were having a hyper lower doses, who are having a kyphosis, who are fat.
Of course, you cannot see that from a picture.
No, no, and, but also, even me as a young kid and a young adult, I thought, all right, they have the papers, so they must be the OGs. They must be fixing me. But after years and years and years, nobody was fixing me, and that was so because they were watching this particle and not this particle.
Yeah. So your experience, your curiosity, and all your experience together made you change that mindset, right? But the first thing you went to is to people with a lot of diplomas or good research or a lot of awards. So that's what I tried to give you an answer. You can't know if something is really good, yes or no. I go to Bart K because Bart K has 20 years of experience and was in the research world and was saying, what? I feel more like a con man than a researcher. And his explanation about it made common sense to me. Yeah, but so then he has to show research about his how do you say that? He has to show research about his experiences to give me the research I can read so that I know that he is right about other research. No, that's not how it works. Sometimes you talk with somebody and you feel, okay, this somebody is an expert, and is everything he's saying then absolutely true? No. Ask questions. Ask a lot of questions. Learn how to ask good questions. And that's an experience gain. And that's using a lot of science in the form of math or physics to ask the question objectively without. And you can do that in your words as well. Try to inform yourself in semantics. So in the use of words. So you can ask somebody a question in an objective way.
Like?
For example, if I'm going to ask you something, then I only want to use words who have a frame of reference, so that are in the real world. So let's say you and I want to build a bridge. Do we go to a butcher to build a bridge and ask him his opinion about our plan, about our paper, about the metal we use, about the torsion strength or compression strength or anything? I guess not. I think we go to somebody who's experienced in building bridges. But do we have the certainty that that guy we go to is making sure that our bridge is not going to collapse?
This person probably does because he knows math.
Absolutely. So we're communicating through math. Mm-hmm. And then we have a higher certainty of an objective answer. Mm-hmm. But is it 100% sure that his research is flawless?
Yeah.
It's not. So focusing on research is good, but you have to mix it with experience and common sense.
Mm.
That's my opinion.
Yeah, I can agree on that.
<All right. laughs> We don't have to agree on anything, on everything, of course. I mean, it's just, there again, it's context as well. So, but I learned a lot from Alfred Kosipsky. He's somebody who's specialized in semantics.
All right.
Alfred Kosipsky, sorry. And he's an engineer. And
did he also teach Einstein?
Yeah, he teaches Einstein a lot. Yeah. And from his books, I learned to ask better questions, more objective questions, change my language a little bit, and experience on that. So, but if you want to know if research is okay, yes, I would go to Bart K, and I would learn a lot from Jacques Fresco, because he teaches you the skills how to test if something is valid, yes or no.
Yeah, and you have to know yourself. I learned it at school and teach myself, even with all the things I wrote on the internet, but not always going to people and ask them. You have to think when you have to think. You
have to learn to think for yourself and not think in the dogma of your education you got. And Fresco, Alfred Kosipsky, there are not a lot of people who are doing that. People are not, at school you're not taught how to think, but what to think in a lot of cases. And yeah, it's scarce when you learn how to think instead of what to think. And yeah, Alfred Kosipsky, Jacques Fresco, now the Eckler from Functional Patterns. There are a couple people who are learning you how to think, or instead of what to think, when it comes to the internet. And of course, there are a lot of other people.
And what was helping me was doing research myself, doing research, doing a systematic review, doing a meta-analysis. That then you know how it works.
Yes. Yeah. All right. So, do you guys have any other subjects you would like to put in? Put some context on.
Deuterium. In the biohacker community, you are probably in a lot of Facebooks and Instagram pages as well. It's about deuterium, and deuterium is the new hack, and it's the new biohack to fix your health. Now, so you got different forms of water. You got hydrogen at H+, you got also a heavier form of water. Mm-hmm. And a lot of research shown, especially Dr. Doug Wallace is one of the researchers, or Gerald Pollack is one of the researchers, who's shown that a heavier form of water is one of the causes to produce, the body's able to produce less ATP, especially in the mitochondria. So we have a rotator in the mitochondria that produces energy, and when heavier water falls in that nano rotor motor, we produce less ATP. So all the people say, okay, then I'm gonna drink deuterium depleted water.
Mm-hmm.
So we change the heavy water forms, the Ds, for H+, that is a lighter form of water, and we can produce more energy. That's absolutely true. There's nothing wrong with that. But if you have a healthy lifestyle, if you're out in the sun depletes deuterium. Eating a ketogenic diet or animal foods depletes deuterium. Being in from the summer, when there is more deuterium in the water, in fruits, in vegetables, you deplete that in the winter time.
Yeah.
And in the winter time, you don't, animal foods have a lower content of deuterium. So that's also a reason why you deplete it. But your body is perfectly able to do that
When you're not sick, because when you're sick, you have health problems. It can be a great tool in cancer patients or in other kind of health problems. It's a great tool, and it can help you very, very much. But when you're healthy, when you're eating that way, Thomas was telling, I think it's not necessary to spend that much money on it, because it's very expensive. It's like
12 euros a bottle, for example. So it's only a good tool, in my opinion, and I think also in your opinion, because we discussed this a couple weeks ago, if you have a really serious health condition, like cancer or autoimmune condition or something, but not when you're, for example,
when your heteroplasmy is not that high, then you don't need deuterium depleted water.
So that's something I see so much on the internet, like everybody's buying deuterium depleted water for hundreds of euros, and I'm thinking, spend those hundreds of euros for a trip into the tropics. For Merlin went to Mexico, I'm going to Curaçao in a couple of weeks to be in the tropics, have that sun, and then that sun will deplete deuterium. Or go to a ketogenic diet, don't spend your money on a half-truth.
All
right.
Vitamin D supplements. We talked about supplements. In the Netherlands, it's very common to use vitamin D supplements in winter at high doses. And I think they forgot the context about the balance. We used to getting low levels in winter and high levels in summer. So why are you giving yourself high doses of vitamin D3 in winter? I think most of the people forgot that vitamin D3 is fat soluble. It can be stored at your body, in your organs, for months. So when you get enough sun in spring, in summer, in autumn, you have enough vitamin D3 to go low in winter.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't need that vitamin D3 in winter in you take isolates, you take oral vitamin D3. It's not it's different from the sun. So a vitamin D3 from a bottle, that's what everyone's telling. Oh, I take a sun uit de potje. And it's not the way to go. And I think very high standing people in the Netherlands, high standing coaches, everyone is speaking about the vitamin D3, but
they're not speaking about the feedback loop, the forward loop. They're not speaking about that you have to be hydrated for the supplements to work well. They're not speaking about that the supplements are
not so
expensive and when the sun is for free, so just go out.
And vitamin D3 is not sulfated. It's very different.
But the sun, I mean, there's no vitamin D in the whole year coming out of the sun, right?
Yeah. But you
not the whole year, what do you mean? Just in winter time here in Holland?
No, in the summer you have vitamin D in the sunlight, but in the winter there's
You have UVB light that produces vitamin D.
Alright.
Yeah.
There's not directly coming vitamin D.
That's not what I'm saying, but I think I remember the production of vitamin D is much higher in the summer than in the winter.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely, because the UVB radiation is not here at the moment. Tomorrow we get UVB again, so you can build your vitamin D.
Yep.
But if you're outside, if you're living like an animal, like you should, living outdoors, or at least spend your time as much as possible outdoor. I know people have to go to the office and they have to go to work, but you can produce enough vitamin D if you spend your weekends as much as you can outside, naked. And what I mean with naked is don't protect the skin.
Yeah, standing next to it on the balcony like this while the grandmas from the neighborhood are watching.
And then your levels of vitamin D go high enough.
Yeah.
So you can survive the winter with a good amount of vitamin D instead of non-sulfated, expensive, and a lot of them supplements with vitamin D3 have a lot of toxins in them as well. Same goes for B12, a lot of aldehydes, a certain type of chemical that is really toxic for the body, are found in a lot of supplements.
And that's what we mean with context. The people who are taking vitamin D3 are even wearing sunglasses, so they don't have the information to think and make good choices. Because why the hell are you wearing sunglasses and taking vitamin D3? You're fucking wall the system up.
So why are you fucking the system up when you're wearing sunglasses?
Because you have the suprachiasmatic nuclei in your head. It's the main clock who is regulating the circadian rhythm. When they get signals from the eye and the skin. So when you are wearing sunglasses, you're blocking the photic input. So you can't make vitamin D3 when you're wearing that much clothes and have a sunglass on your eye, and you're making a mismatch when you don't have any clothes on and wearing
You do have clothes on.
So when you're naked, you can wear sunglasses. Preferably not.
No.
But otherwise, absolutely.
No, never wear sunglasses.
No, never.
When I teach health with small children, I always say, hey, look at this plant. If I put a tarp over that plant, how well would that plant do if we let it there for, let's say, 36 hours? All the children say, no, that's not good for the plant. No. Put a tarp over your eyes, put the clothing over your skin. How well are you going to do? Not that good, because you need the radiation from the sun for your health in general, but also to produce vitamin D. Mm. So, no, never. I don't give a fuck if you're in Africa, on the equator, no, don't wear sunglasses. The only context where you can wear sunglasses is when you're skiing down a mountain,
hill,
or behind
beyond glass in a car.
Then you're already behind glass, and UV content is already.
And when you can't handle the sun, you have to ask yourself, am I enough outdoors? And
yeah,
I don't think so.
Of course, a very big thing in capitalism. I mean, companies want you to be scared of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
They want you to be scared
of sun. Yeah.
And yeah, the Mayas, the Egyptians, they all worship the sun for a great reason.
Especially for that, don't wear sunglasses because you have to let your body know how late it is. So when you're going outside in the morning, you get light frequencies that tells your body, the sun is coming, the sun is coming. So you don't burn that day that easy when you have told your body, the sun is coming, and you get UVA, you get AM light. And when you're wearing the sunglasses, your body didn't know.
You're such a sophisticated machine, and every frequency of the sun prepares you for something else. So if you get AM morning light, there's no UV in there. Mm-hmm. It tells the body, when the radiation is at a certain density, that there is coming UV down the road later on at afternoon, and it already changes some proteins and water and collagen in your skin to protect yourself from the UV radiation that's coming. Now you're missing morning light, you're missing evening light, your circadian rhythm is fucked up, and you think, I go to Curaçao for 1 week, lay on the beach between 11 and 5 when the UV is as high as what? I lay down in the sun when all the other animals go to the shade. We go lay down in the sun and then say, the sun is bad and it creates melanoma and stuff like that.
You're using it not in a good way.
Yeah, you're missing the whole
point. You're asking the wrong question. Yeah. Should I be in the sun all day long?
No.
So especially not for children. Mm-hmm. I think children in the sun is not a thing. Children has to be in the shade. And even for yourself,
you still get radiation from a natural source, but it's less because you're in the shade. And the morning and the evening light are the most important to protect the skin, to set the circadian rhythm right. And can you be in the sun in the summer at the equator? Yeah, of course, your body's able to handle it, but don't overdo it.
Yeah.
And we people tend to overdo it. We don't do it 9 months out of the year, but that 1 month in August, we go at the moment that it's the most there, and can it be dangerous then? Absolutely.
Yeah, and then till 11 entry when the sun is so hard and you're not used.
Yeah, you're not used to it. The system is not prepared to handle that radiation. So there again, context is missing so much when I hear about the sun and melanoma and stuff like that. The sun on itself doesn't give you melanoma. You have to fuck up a lot of other stuff in your lifestyle, to get the melanoma.
Yeah, but who's telling you? So you can't blame people on it
because
they don't know.
People do it with the information they have, and that information is, highly marketed by a lot of companies. Yep.
So what other people have the similar knowledge that you guys do? In the Netherlands, for instance, I know Dennis from I think he has 20 Facebook groups.
Which Dennis?
The big guy who is also very much into
Bart Wolbers.
I think his name is Bart. Right?
Oh, Bart, sorry.
Yeah.
Bart Wolbers. Yeah.
We don't know him because we never meet him in person. So I don't know exactly.
I talked to him once on Skype, but they don't know somebody. So
I think people on the internet, what you read, is not how they are in person.
Yeah, true, but do you guys think there's some people here in the Netherlands who have similar knowledge to you?
Of course there are a lot of good therapists with a lot of knowledge, but the holistic way we're looking at it, I didn't meet the people yet who were and into biomechanics and into quantum biology and automolecular nutrition, and I did not meet people who are well-rounded yet. And we meet a lot of people who have way more knowledge than we have in certain areas, but we don't meet people who are well-rounded. There are coming more people, so the people from Functional Patterns who are doing that, they get a good education from Nadia Egler, not about biomechanics, but in movement in general.
Yeah, but that's about movement. I think a lot of people are doing good things in their own job. Realm. So you have a good holistic dentist in the Netherlands. You have Oersterk. What is his?
Richard Delet.
He's trying to change the system, and we're 100%.
We have a medicine-free a doctor now. I think her name is Marije something.
Oh, that's nice too.
Yeah. She's the first medicine free
doctor. Wim Hof is doing great things. Yeah. Richard the Lab from Oersterk is doing great things as well. But I don't know him personally, but when I see his content on the internet, he's really focused on the food side of things. So yeah, that's good and that's important. But the quantum biology side of things, so using nature's laws in...
I think in America they are a lot further than here. When I was in Mexico,
well.
I spoke to more people that are further than in the Netherlands.
Right.
Yeah.
Guys, when one of the podcasts I did with Ruud Elvers on the topic, what is health in his opinion? And if I recall it correctly, he stated something that when you are in a state of being that is very highly energetic with a highly form of adaptivity, something like that. So you're very adaptive, you're very energetic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you, because I saw that podcast, of course, and you are able to regenerate yourself. So
right.
For example, if you got a flu or anything else, so you're not depending on medicines or supplements to have a stability of health. Mm-hmm. That's what he was saying there. Yeah, I absolutely agree with what he was saying, that You should not depend on supplements or medicines, and you should be in a high energetic state so you can do what you want to do. And another form or another way I see health is dying slowly. And what I mean by that is that you're not exposing your body, or your lifestyle is not making you older quick. You're not driving in that first gear all the time, but you switch with rest. You have good quality rest. So you wear down your body not that quick. So you have that sentence from
I don't think dying slowly is the good word for it, because you don't want to die slowly. You want to live an energetic life to the longest. So mm-hmm. you want to stay vital till you're dying.
80, 85,
yeah,
90, it doesn't matter. But that was exactly what I was meaning by that yeah, you have an optimal health for your context, and you have a lot of energy when you're older as well. You can enjoy life. And what enjoying life is, yeah, that everybody has to make that decision for their own, how they do that and what it is for them. But not being codependent on something, that's really important.
We see a lot of clients that are 40 years old, 35 years old, and saying, yeah, I'm feeling better now than I was 25. So
that's a nice compliment.
That's a nice compliment, yeah.
All right. One of the times you came for dinner by my house, you spoke about the redox zone. And
you got redox potential and exclusion zone.
The exclusion zone, sorry. Exclusion zone. Is there any YouTube material for people they could look that stuff
up?
Yeah,
if you type in Gerald Pollack, he's the founder of the exclusion zone, and it's the fourth phase of water, and it has tremendous influence on your health. So in basically what happens is, if certain type of natural light comes on water, it excludes everything from
positive to negative
and protons, so positive and negative.
And all the toxins, the metals, they are in the middle and they get excluded.
Yeah, detoxify it.
Right,
yes.
So that's
so it's a natural detox system, and it gets started by the sun, and especially the red frequencies, not only red frequencies, but especially the red frequencies of natural sunlight build at the exclusion zone, and that way it becomes easier to produce energy as well.
So
I don't have to.
The sun can give you energy to your body, but can give you energy to food that you can intake.
It's a natural way of producing energy without food, and you need sunlight for that.
All right, because that was one of the things you I think you agreed on with Ruud, that health is the phase you spoke about, mitochondria, what they do during the night. They are
uncoupling, you mean?
Yeah, uncoupling. I don't know.
Uncoupling, what, yeah.
So that's health, in your guys' opinion.
No, not specifically uncoupling as health, but just see it as something.
A very good indicator.
Absolutely. But during the day, you should be having your arms wide, be curious, and go out in the world and have energy. So expand.
So that's dopamine.
Yeah, that's dopamine. And during the night, you have to go to rest. Digestive tract goes down a little, and you have to repair. So you're a little bit more inside. So expand, retract, expand, retract. If you're able to expand during the day and retract or recover during the night, that's a pretty good indicator of health. And that translates itself in good sleep quality. So you're not waking up, you feel rested when you wake up, you have the energy to do whatever you want during the day, and you're not getting the flu, because you're not built to have the flu. The flu is something that you shouldn't get. Mm-hmm. When you have a proper immune system or you have optimal health. So yeah, that's a pretty good indicator. Are you flexible in your way of thinking, in your body? Can you expand and retract with your voice, with your body language, with everything? That's just a cycle of day and night.
Mm.
Are you able to be in day and night, or are you overactive all the time, or are you sleepy and sluggish during the day? Then something is off there.
Yeah, right. And can you do everything that you want to do?
All right, so on that topic, what are your guys' morning rituals, for instance?
Morning rituals. I wake up, I feel that I'm awake. I'm thinking what I'm doing for the day and think how I feel. What do I need today? What do I like to do? Where is the day for? I skip the phone. I don't look at my phone for exactly 1 hour till my morning ritual is finished. Now it's winter. First thing I do is opening and looking outside, going outside. Sometimes for a walk, sometimes just chilling in the garden. When it's possible, I don't do any shoes on.
Mm-hmm. So you're grounding.
Yeah, so then I'm grounding. I love to go for a walk, but yeah, it's not always possible. And sometimes I train fasted, so then I'm going for a run or something. And then I make breakfast. What I like to eat that day. So I'm thinking about how do I feel? What do I need? Do I like eggs? Do I like other kinds of things that I wanted to eat? And just chill, just relax, take time. I think it's very important to start the morning slowly and not have the rush of the day, rushing to the office, rushing to work, because then you're ruled by the job and not ruled by how you feel. So the morning is the most important thing of the day for me.
Mm. All right. Yeah. And what is your morning routine, Thomas?
Yeah, it looks almost the same. I schedule my calendar that I always have the time to see the sunrise. So I go outside as naked as possible, even in the winter, just shorts. Go outside, chill in the garden, or maybe go for a walk. I do that at least 30, 40 minutes. Sometimes I read the newspaper, sometimes I read a book. After that, depending on which season it is, I go work out outside as well. Or I go inside and make my breakfast, and I make sure that I don't get blue light or fake light until 12, 1. So the practice where I work is as only red light. At home we have red light. So yeah, I'm focused on a couple things that I wake up in the way I want to wake up, and that's reconnect with nature.
Mm-hmm.
You're not connected when you're sleeping because you're in the house. So I reconnect with nature, get some good quality food in, take time to prepare that food, do some meditation or read a book that I like, and then my day starts. And people say, yeah, but I have a 9-to-5 job and everything. Yeah, before I was also studying for a 9-to-5 job, but I changed my calendar slowly to be able to do the morning ritual that I want.
Mm. So. All right. And what is an absolute non-negotiable for you when it comes to doing something daily?
What do you mean?
So let's, for instance, you have the habit of drinking tea. And I take it away from you. It's a non-negotiable for you to do. You have to do it every day or every week.
I think for me, AM light. When I don't take the AM light, maybe it's a mindset thing, but I have to take the AM light. Otherwise, I'm not feeling fully energized for that day. So I think that's pretty important for me. For you?
Artificial light. I don't allow artificial light, especially not from a blue source. So I do some red light, but I also try to not do the red light as much as I can. So artificial light. And when there is artificial light, there's one exception when I don't wear my blue blockers, and that's during this podcast. But when I'm working, when I'm inside in a restaurant, morning, midday, night, I don't mind. I 99% of the time wear my blue blockers.
Yeah, and when you're not used to it, you can't handle it anymore, because I don't feel well when I'm under artificial light at night. I am under artificial light at night, at daytime, but I cannot handle it at night anymore.
All right.
And my sleep schedule. I don't interrupt my sleep schedule that, that easily. So I have to have a good reason to go to late.
Yeah, later.
Yeah, late.
Okay. All right. All right. Well, thank you very much for the interview, guys. People can find you on yourhealthconcept.nl. And they also have an Instagram page, which is also translated into English, if I'm not mistaken.
Absolutely, you can press on Instagram
exactly.
And it's translated in English.
So you're doing business for folks like me, but also for companies these days.
Absolutely, yeah. We give advice for the whole company to change the surroundings of the company to create a better health environment for the company.
And I, as a very known person for you, I highly advise the work of these two folks. He walks around with glasses all the time. He also has energy, but he also likes to drink wine and have a laugh. So thank you very much, guys,
for the
talk of today. You can find Inge Damas, of course, on Instagram, Facebook, even LinkedIn and YouTube, of course. And if you have any particular questions about today's talks, topics, feel free to drop them in the comments, and see you next time. Cheers.